Claire Dunn is the star and co-writer of the new film Herself. I'm Kevin Jacobson of Gold Derby here with Claire. And let's just start with how you conceived of this idea. You know, this is your first screenplay that has been produced. You star in the film. So what was it that kind of inspired you to tell this story?
Well, at the time I was just acting and living in New York briefly just to try out the pilot season. So I was actually reading scripts a lot every day. And then one day, one of my best friends in the world called me from Dublin, and she's a single mother with three kids. And she called me saying, "I don't believe this. Like, I feel like I'm in some weird other world," because she was like, "I have to leave this property within a month. I've just been given a month's notice, but there's nothing online. Like, I can't find anywhere to live." So as it creeped near the end of the month, basically, she had nowhere to move to because there was a housing crisis in Dublin. And I was just so fired up on her behalf. And I was standing there in New York going, "I can't believe that I'm here basically doing a million auditions, not getting anywhere as an actress. And my best mate is basically homeless, like, and has to declare herself homeless." And I was just like, it just should not be like this, you know. And it was really a basic kind of urge in me. And then I started googling basically and fantasizing on her behalf about self-building. So I googled self-build Ireland and then added the word cheap, and then I found that Dominic Stevens had designed this house for himself. He's an architect and professor, and he designed something for only 25,000 euro. And I was like, what? This is incredible. This is like a whole house, like it's a proper house. And so I got in touch with him somehow online and started asking questions about it. And then a few hours later, I was sitting there and it was just this story kind of flashed before my eyes. And I was like, "What? Why don't I just tell the story of a woman who actually decides to do this, like go on a quest to build a house for herself. And she transforms her whole life. And she goes from such an old, dark place in whatever she was into this whole new world with new tribe of people around her, and transforms herself and her life." Like, so that's kind of where it came from.
Well, I feel like your character Sandra is very aware of herself and her situation, and she sees kind of how other people are reacting to her and all the judgments that they can make. And it seems like she tries to really take charge, you know, and kind of take control of her own narrative in a way, you know, rather than letting the narrative control her. And I'm curious just how you went about figuring out who Sandra really is when you were writing it.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Like, I think you're getting at exactly basically what I was determined to do, which was not portray a kind of victim or the typical, like, I feel like there is an archetype of the battered woman, essentially. And it was like, I met women who had been through hell and they were out the other side. I'd met the key workers that work with those people. Like, I'm sorry, it's not just women, it is men as well, I should say, and trans and all sorts of people go through this kind of thing. But essentially, the thing about meeting these incredible people, I realized a huge amount of resilience was in their story and bravery, not just to leave, but to stay and endure it for so long because there was no other choice. So there's a kind of like strange, quiet determination, a silent survivor that exists in these people. It's kind of like, I read an amazing book about this where it aligns trauma and the things that you suffer during domestic violence right alongside what people in the World War II camps suffered and what soldiers go through. Like, it literally, this is a huge scientific, like, academic book on it. And it's like, it's amazing what you do to just get through the day, like, and get through something where somebody else has complete control of your universe and how you mind the tiny bit of universe that might be just yours. And so for Sandra, her thing is about, she is dying to have her own actual arena, like her own little universe for her and her two girls. And I just always wanted to get that tone of determination, steeliness and grit, because every woman that I met along the way, especially the first woman that I ever talked to about my film, she was like, "Oh my God, please, are you just going to show a story of one of us that actually comes out the other side? Because loads of us do." And also, will you please not show us as such victims? Like, that's all she said to me. That's the only two things she said to me. And I said, yeah, I'll do that. So that's where that comes from, is basically from the requests of the people themselves that have done it.
Yeah. Well, since you're starring in the film as well, did you find yourself kind of discovering anything through the actual performance of Sandra that you hadn't really planned on from the script?
Yeah, like I would say I discovered that, I only discovered in the playing of it how hard it must be when you've been through things like that with a person. It's very hard to trust people and trust yourself. And the journey of trust she went on, I was like, oh my God, like it's so hard for her to ask for help from people she's never really spoken to too much, or even just to dialogue with people that she's never really talked to before. And also I realized that she almost feels ashamed of her story. And then in the end, I think she just accepts that this is just part of her life, but it's not all of her. Like, it's like she has to accept it as part of the story, but that it doesn't define her. And I didn't quite know that. Like, I knew it maybe, but I really knew it then when I played her, you know?
Yeah, and I don't know if I would call this an overtly political film, but it feels like you are making somewhat of a statement here about, you know, the housing system and the problems that come up when someone like Sandra is in this really impossible situation. Was that kind of a subtle commentary, something that you always had in mind when you were writing it?
Yeah, I mean, I see it's a fiction based on fact, and there's a lot of research and there's a lot of real figuring out that I had to do. Like, I just had to do endless research on building houses and how much things cost. But then I also had to figure out what Sandra lives on, what she earns, and how she gets by on the different things like rental allowance or one parent family supplement or things like that that are in the Dublin system. And I wouldn't say I started out wanting to be political, but the more I researched, I was like, okay, well, it's quite obvious that they're spending way too much money on the temporary accommodation bills, like paying hotels to house people, when they could put that money towards actually building the houses. Like, as in, like, I mean, they have to put money towards housing them while they build the houses, but I just mean like the sheer amount of money shocked me to pieces. So I was just kind of like, I have to somehow get that in. I would say, though, my determination in the film politically, if there was any political or social comment to make, I was sort of not wanting to be... I love Ken Loach, right, and I love his films, but I didn't want to do a Ken Loach film. I wanted to think about... I was sort of more obsessed with who we really are deep down in, as human beings. And because over my life, I realised I've been a bit obsessed with sociology. So I'd read a lot of books about how everything ties together. So I wouldn't say I'm a politician or I can say I know exactly what should be done about this, that and the other. But I certainly love to have a bit more of a wide scope picture on those things and at least have some understanding. And my thing is that I always come back to the same principle, which is like most things could be solved a lot quicker if we all actually talked and actually listened. Because that's half the problem. It's just like communication of what needs to happen and then joining, like just joining the threads. And you know, anyway, I won't get on a soapbox, don't worry.
You're good. Well, I know that you've worked with Phyllida Lloyd before on the Shakespeare trilogy, which is a miniseries. What does she kind of give you as a director that makes her stand out, maybe compared to other directors that you've worked with?
I'd say the thing that stands out about Phyllida is that she's the ultimate collaborator and cares about the story as much, maybe she even cares about it more than me. And that when I was working with her, I realized I'd gotten used to her kindness and her wish for other people to give her opinions. And like she'd be asking, you know, the lighting assistant or the runner who's not even getting paid, what do you think of that setup? Do you think that's good? And they'd be like, yeah, I think it's pretty, like, you know. And then they'd come over to me and go, Phyllida asked me what I think of that, like, but I don't know why she asked me. And I was like, oh, well, Phyllida just asks everybody questions about what they think of the story. Are we getting something across clearly? Because that's her way, like, that's her way. She's all inclusive, and she's all about clarity of storytelling and pulling at the heartstrings. And if she's not doing it for every single person on that set, then she'll worry that she's not getting something right. So I think that's what marks her out. I also think she just probably brings you to a place of performance that you don't even notice you're getting to. She does it so surreptitiously. She never, also, this is a true statement, she never shouts or raises her voice. I mean, ever. I've never heard her raise her voice. It's so weird. She just speaks very quietly and everybody comes closer and we all focus together on the thing. And I think that's beautiful. I think that's one of her most distinctive qualities.
It's a very harmonious set, I can imagine. Yeah. And Harriet Walter, she is playing a woman who your character pleads for, and she's a widower, and she basically kind of donates her land in a way to Sandra to build this house. I mean, what is it like working with her, someone of her stature who's been in the business for decades now?
And working with Harriet was like meeting one of my idols, to be honest, the first time I met her, because I worked with her in theater with Phyllida. So that's why it was such an amazing, you know, collaboration, all three of us being involved in the film. But working with her on this was particularly special because Harriet gets exactly where I come from as an artist and a storyteller and an actress. And it's very similar to where she comes from. And she really believes that stories can change how we think about things or have an effect on people that see it, but not in an airy-fairy way. Like, she's very, like, I'm the one that's not too political. She's very political and socially aware and always doing a huge amount of charity work and work to improve human rights for people and all sorts. She's an absolute legend. So to have her behind the character of Peggy, who is a woman that, like, is willing to let go of possession and let go of land in order to help the future, I think for Harriet to represent that woman was huge to me, because I think Harriet is the same as me, where she's quite concerned about the planet over the next 10 years and just, like, is so into young people and what are we doing to turn this ship around? Like, what are we doing for the climate change? What are we doing now with this pandemic? That's what she's into. And I think she enjoyed getting to be a person that had lived such a full life, had a lot of her own grief and pains, but was still willing to give something to the future generations in such a generous way. And yet it's sort of effortless as well. She was kind of saying to me that, like, it's not like Peggy's a saint. She also gains something from all this as well. But all she has to do is just let you onto the land. It was never going to be used anyway. And she goes, she said, like, herself, she was saying to me, I just hope a lot of landlords see that. Just like, or people that are hanging on to properties that are just wasting away and they're just stood there to build up value rather than be a home for people. And so, yeah, it was incredible having her play the role. I also got to stay in her house once for a couple of months when we were acting together, and I wrote a couple of drafts of this in her attic. And I always kind of think I just have a special homage to her home and her attic for being a place where I wrote the film for a while.
Yeah, that's kind of meta in a way, with the film being what it is. I mean, I imagine there's something kind of meta actually about this being such a special project for you and being part of it from that infancy stage. And then here it is, it's complete, you know, just as we have Sandra going through this entire production of building her own house and seeing it through to the end. So what was it like for you to actually finally see the entire film from start to finish?
It was incredibly nail-biting and scary. I did see a few edits along the way. So that wasn't that fun at the start. And then there was this day where they had finished all the sound mix. And Phil had said, I'd love you to come into this studio in London in Soho. And I was like, all right, yeah. And I came in, she's like, I just wanted you to check something out. And I came in and they had this lovely big screen and this like lovely leather couch. And it was like Warner Brothers or something, the studios. And they like brought me like my favorite coffee and some chocolates. And they sat me down. They were like, right, now watch your movie. And I was like, okay. She's like, you can make notes if you want, but I don't think you'll have any. And I just sat there watching it. And that was the first time I ever really saw it in its full, with its full production value and the credits and everything. And it was, it gave me shivers. I just was sitting there and I was like, it's already weird that I'm just sitting in this amazing studio in Soho in London, just being like, whoa, like this is so fancy. And then I was watching my own movie completed and I felt like the luckiest person in the world. But then seeing it in Sundance with my parents there, and the whole world seeing it, well, the world on some level seeing it for the first time, that was really, really special. That was something I'll never forget, a milestone in my life, definitely.
Seeing such a great critical response too. Yeah. People really responded to it. Yeah, right?
Yeah.
I mean, speaking to that, let's just talk about this. You received a nomination from the British Independent Film Awards for Best Actress. Congrats on that. How did that feel to get that recognition, especially again for like a real passion project of yours?
Yeah, I just suddenly was like, you know, you well, for me anyway, I suddenly felt like it was very weighted, like something heavy and real has just been like validated, like a stamp on top of this film just there by getting that nomination. As in, it's like, whoa, that makes it suddenly a real, it's a proper film with high quality storytelling going on. And I was like, I'm very, very proud of that. I'm also just like, things like Variety listing it as one of the films to see from 2020, like things like that. Like, it's very hard to take it in. It's very hard to take it in. It's a huge, huge, huge compliment, but also like, I'm gonna remember that and I'm gonna have a copy of that like forever and just be like, that was my first feature and it did okay.
Yeah. You know? Well, Claire, congrats on the film and your nomination. Thank you so much for talking to me today.
Thank you so much. Cheers.
Yeah. And for those of you watching, hit like and subscribe for more interviews and go to goldderby.com to make your awards season predictions.